Good morning. I am Santosh Bhatti. I am going to discuss about the mobile communication. Basically, the mobile communication is a part of wireless communication. Now, question is, right here, what is wireless communication? Yeah? Communication between transmitter to receiver without wire is known as wireless communication. Or, in other words, we can say, the transmitting or receiving bytes and data using the electromagnetic wave in three states is known as wireless communication. Right? Actually, in the wireless communication, there are different properties. First one is the information from sender to receiver is carried over a well-defined frequency band. Well-defined frequency band. Frequency band means the specific frequency bands are defined for the different communication purposes. First of all, for the GSM, if you are taking the example of the mobile communication, mobile application, for the GSM, the frequency band is different. For the CDMS, the frequency band is different. For the satellite communication, the frequency band is different. We can see that for the wireless communication, it is the carrier based and well-defined frequency band. The next one is that each channel has a fixed frequency, fixed bandwidth and a capacity. Fixed frequency means now it has given the fixed frequency band for the communication purpose. And today, what is the bit rate? In digital communication, the bit rate bandwidth is defined by half of the bit rate. And today, the bit per minute. Bit per second, the transmission of bit per second is known as bit rate. Bit rate. For example, suppose we have 10101011. There are 8 bits. The bit rate is defined by RB. This is equal to 8 BPS. 8 bits per second. How to calculate the required bandwidth for the transmission of this 8 bits? Data bandwidth sequences, so bandwidth is half of the bit rate. That is 4 bit per second. Next one, the different channel can be used to transmit information parallel independently. If one of the channel is busy, then in same time, parallel, they can use the other channel for the transmission purpose. And they transmit their information independently. So this is basically regarding the wireless communication. Now next one, how many types of wireless communication? Basically the wireless communication is characterized only three parts. One is the mobile, other is the portable wireless communication, and third one is the fixed wireless communication. In mobile wireless communication, basically the cellular phone are used in the mobile wireless communication. Cellular means either the transmission through the GSM. GSM stands for Global System for Mobile or CDMA. So these two under comes the mobile wireless communication. In your daily life, you are using day to day. And next one is the portable wireless communication. In portable wireless communication, the IEEE 802.11b, basically this IEEE standard for the Wi-Fi. So Wi-Fi, basically nowadays you are using the Wi-Fi system or Wi-Fi devices. Now Wi-Fi, the input to the Wi-Fi devices is connected to the LAN, Google Area Network, and it through the electromagnetic wave in the environment. For this, you can connect the more number of electronic devices to the this portable device means Wi-Fi device. Now, other portable wireless device is known as UWB, Ultra Wi-Fi. This is from IEEE standard, IEEE 802.15.3. Now, next, what is the fixed wireless communication? So So, first is wireless communication. Now, IEEE standard is IEEE 802.16. Now, it is used as a wireless MAN. MAN stands for Metropolitan Area Network. And the next slide, I've mentioned the different frequencies for the broadcasting of the different systems, different system, communication system. If you are transmitting your signal to the AM modulation or AM broadcasting, now the frequency range is 535 to 1605 kHz. Minimum frequency is 535 kHz and maximum frequency is 1605 kHz or 1.605 MHz. If you are considering FM radio, the minimum frequency is 88 MHz and the frequency range for the FM is 88 to 102 MHz. So, just given the minimum frequency range, it starts a different communication system. And for the JSON mode, it is 900 MHz. For global positioning system, 1.2 GHz. For PCS mode, person, computer to 1.8 GHz. For Bluetooth, it is 2.4 GHz. For Wi-Fi, it is also 2.4 GHz. So these are the important frequency, minimum frequency for the required for the second communication system. Now question is arises here, why is wireless communication? What is the need of wireless communication? Why you are choosing, you are talking by your basic phone or wired system. So there are so many advantages of the wireless communication. The first one is the freedom from the wire. If you are comparing with the conventional communication or wireline communication, the transmitters are connected with some physical medium. Physical medium means source or destination are connected by some physical medium. Physical medium, this physical medium acts as a node and a channel. This physical medium may be the switched pair, transceiver, panel wire, or maybe waveguide, maybe optical fiber cable. So these physical devices or physical medium are increasing the total cost of the communication system. So there are big advantages of wireless communication is the freedom from wire, freedom from the physical medium. Then if the freedom from the physical medium is, it drastically reduces the total cost of the communication system. So there are some points, freedom from the wire, no cost of installing wire, rewiring, no cost of installation wire or rewiring, it reduces the cost of the physical medium. Next one is the low purchase of wires running from there to there. For example, if you are connecting your transmitter to receiver up to 10 km, up to 100 km from one state to other state or from one country to another country, they needed the bunches of wires. They needed the bunches of wires or bundles of wires. Basically, this increases the total cost of the communication system. And the big advantage, the automobile is the daily communication without physical connection. For example, if you are using the portable devices, I mean Wi-Fi devices and Bluetooth devices, now you can connect one device with the other, with transmitter to the receiver with the Wi-Fi devices without putting anywhere any physical medium between these two. And easily you can transfer or transmit your data from one point to another point. Other advantages of the wireless communication is the global coverage. Means if you want to transmit your signal in a hilly area, because in hilly area, in the sea area, it is impossible to put the wire, put the physical medium between transmitter to receiver. But in the wireless communication, it is easy. Now you can transmit your signal through the antenna at one point and it throw out the electromagnetic waves in the environment. So global coverage can be possible by the wireless communication. And third one, what is the STC connected? STC connected, I mean, if any, if you are comparing the wire communication system, if any damage occurs the physical medium, I mean some kind of physical medium, they are not connected, now what? Communication is not possible. But there is wireless communication, because there is no use of the physical medium, now they are still connected from transmitter to receiver. But the next advantage is flexibility. Flexibility means it is very flexible. That's why the service is free, you, whenever you go, I mean mobility is possible. In wireless communication, now you can talk with the moving, you are traveling, and then you can talk and you can use the communication system or communication services. So flexibility is possible in the wireless communication compared to wireless communication. So basic mantra, basic property of wireless communication is it stay connected anywhere and anytime. So these are the basically related to wireless communication. There are so many challenges for the wireless communication system. So many challenges means, by wireless communication system, you can transmit your signals to the antenna. In terms of the mobile system, this is called base station. Base station, basically this is the transmitter. It transfers the signal to the antenna, the environment, right? And at the user destination point, at the user point of view, for example, you are using the mobile phone. In mobile phone, these are the battery operated devices. These are the limitations of the power, limitations of the energy. So, big challenge is the efficient hardware. Efficient hardware means, its sensitivity must be very, very high. Means it uses a low power transmitter, low power receiver, or low power signal processing tool for the purpose of signal processing before transmission and after reception of the signal. Right? So next challenge is the efficient use of the finite radio spectrum. Because this is the battery operated devices, now power may be drained out. Then efficient use of the finite radio spectrum. For example, if you are making a call, if channel are busy, now it is facility to connect the zero signal to the declined channel by using the frequency reduced or by using the MAC protocol. By using the medium access protocol. Other next challenge is the integrated services. Integrated services means by wireless we can integrate more devices simultaneously, we can transmit our signal, our data, our multimedia over the single network. And services differentiation, priorities or resources sharing. For example, at the same time, if you want to run your signal, if you want to read email, or you want to take a print out, you want to connect your printer, on a saving basis you can connect the services wirelessly. And next is the network support for user mobility. For mobile scenario is very, very important. Now, with the mobility you can use the services of the wireless community system. Maintaining quality of the services over the unreliability. Maintaining unreliability performance. Quality of the services of communication system is defined by signal to noise ratio. Signal to noise ratio means if the value of signal to noise ratio is very, very dark, means receive signal quality is very good. Now, how do you use signal to noise ratio? If the noise is connected to the system is very, very small. If noise is small, noise power is very small. If noise power is very small, means signal to noise ratio ultimately is the dash. If signal to noise ratio is large, means it is signal quality is very useful. And next is the cost efficiency, wireless communication. Now, if you design the wireless system, now it is almost cost effective. Because if you are comparing the wireless system with the wire system, because there is no need of the wire, no need of the physical medium, now cost is also minimum than the wireless system. But here, if you are comparing wireless system with the wire system, there is more data, that is the saving. Second means signal strength is reducing if any obstacle is found between transmitter and receiver. For example, suppose you are transmitting near the base station and near the user. There is a user in between. Now this area is known as the propagation path. Yes, if in between the base station and the mobile user there are so many obstacles, maybe some building, some forest, some hill, the signal strength is reduced whenever you are moving far away from the base station. If you are still there, now maybe signal fluctuating, signal strength is fluctuating slightly, but if you are moving far away from the base station, then the signal strength is continuously decreasing. So this decreasing signal strength is known as threading. So there is a threading problem in the wireless communication. In wireless communication there is no threading problem because directly transmitter is connected with the receiver from physical medium. So this threading is not most severe in the wireless communication. Why in wireless communication it is very severe. Then multipath means each one transmits your signal to the base station. Here the user, here the base station. Suppose there is some building, tiny building, some race goes here, some race comes here, some race comes here, some here. Here again one building, it comes, some race here, some race here. So by the multipath setting, also the signal strength is decreased. Signal strength is decreases. So these are the big problem, big challenge in the wireless communication system. Right? And in wireless communication, we need a very high security because the signal, electromagnetic waves are traveling in the open environment. Three states. So anyone can detect your signal. So it needs the strongest security mechanism for the authentication of the signal. Right? So these are the, when you design the wireless communication system, these points must be keep in your mind. These are the challenge, big challenges of the wireless communication system. Now, earlier I told you now mobile communication is a part of wireless communication. Wireless communication may be the fixed kind or may be the moving kind. So moving kind of the wireless system is known as mobile system. Right? So here we know that wireless network essentially means mobile. Right? Wireless system may be fixed or mobile. Fixed means fixed wireless system is usually the metropolitan area network. Means my network and this year are mobile. The mobile phone has come under the mobile communication. Now the representation of the mobile signal. Now this type of signals are used in the mobile communication system. The there are two types of the signal. Continuous time signal, discrete time signal. Right? So any kind of signal can be transmitted to the mobile communication, to the wireless communication. Yes? But the signal strength depends upon the different factor. Yes? So here you can see the wave propagation mechanism is closely affected by the wavelength. A wave propagation mechanism is closely affected by the wavelength of the propagation frequency. Propagation frequency means if you are the propagation path or the threading depends upon the propagation frequency. In other words, you can say if you are increasing the frequency of operation, now you can transmit your signal to the long distance, to the far distance. At the same time, if you are increasing the frequency, what is an attenuation? Also increases. So this is the drawback of increasing the frequency, right? So in mobile radio environment, the propagation path does not only involve frequency and distance, but also antenna height at the base station, at the mobile unit, and the civilian transportation and human man-made environment. The signal distance of the signal depends upon specifically the terrain configuration and the human-made environment. Human-made environment is basically the rural area, what is urban area, suburban area, and agrarian area. Yes, human-made means basically this is the depend upon the building. So very nice of building and terrain transportation, basically the open area, flat terrain, hilly terrain, mountain area. So signal distance also depends upon these two terrains. Right? Now the next slide you can see graphically, this is the base station. This is the base station, means base station consists of the antenna, falling to the transmit, you can radiate your the signal in the environment. So this is the antenna, this is the system of antenna, this is the omnidirectional antenna, means radiate the radiating the all direction, right? And these are the human made structure, I mean building. Yes, now this car is basically to the user. Yes, now this from here to here, this part towards the propulsion part. So this is the central diagram of the base station. This is the building, these are the users. How to determine the signal distance from transmitter to receiver? I mean base station to user. So from next diagram you can see the top view of this. This is the base station antenna, these are the users, and this is the propagation path. Yes? For example, suppose ray goes this building and reflected back here, then come to here. Again, these are the engines. These lines through the incoming electromagnetic waves to the engine. Yes? So there are multiple signals reaching at the user point. So this area is known as propagation path. And this is the multi path threading region. Multi path means multiple paths. The ray comes, electromagnetic waves receive the region with the multiple path. That's why it is called multi path. Right? Now how to determine the signal distance? Now next diagram you can see that the field distance. The first diagram plot between the elevation above the sea level in the field and the sea level. Sea level means now this is situated the antenna height. This antenna height is basically 30 feet to 100 feet. From the sea level. So this is the sea level. Now we can put the base station antenna at 100 feet and this is the user. This is the user. From you can see from the next diagram, part A. When user goes away from the base station. User goes away from the base station. So near the base station, if user is at here, it has a very good signal distance. At this point, when distance is increased, they are then good. When distance is increased, the user goes away from the base station, now signal distance continuously decreases. Now, you can see that at this point, now the range increases, at this point, the range increases, at this point, the range increases. This is because of some obstacles come between the base station antenna to the receiving antenna. And the base station to the user. Now these obstacles may be some building, maybe hills, maybe some moving obstacles, maybe some moving obstacles. Right? So this is the diagram for the signal distance. Now this RT, RS represent the signal distance of the receiving signal. RS basically receive signal distance in the space domain. RT is the receive signal distance in the time domain. Right? So this is the closer view of the this fluctuation of the signal. Right? Now in the next diagram, you can see sphere. Sphere you can see basically this is the third number. This is the base station. And this is the user. This is the user. Maybe sometimes this user is traveling with this distance. This is fuel for given speed. Sometimes we traveling in this direction with a vehicle speed. Sometimes traveling in this direction with a vehicle speed. Sometimes traveling this vehicle speed. Now, when speed is varying, speed is varying and direction of motion is varying. Now, what is the effect of single distance is represented by this diagram. You can see here, if user is moving at the speed of V, if user mobile is moving, given the signal distance is very likely. Well, if traveling in this direction with the vehicle speed, now signal distance almost will be constant, and if a signal comes constantly, then comes, if traveling with the vehicle speed, now signal distance is like this, before speed, signal distance is like this. Right? So these are the basically signal distance if user moving away from the base distance. In reverse way, if you can see here, if user move in this direction, user go in this direction means signal distance is increased. For example, here moving in this direction, signal distance is increased. Right? Now, in the next slide, you can see the causes of propagation path loss. Causes of propagation path loss is depend upon the antenna rate, transmitting antenna rate, receiving antenna rate, and the distance between transmitter to receiver. Distance between transmitter to receiver and the operating frequency. At the operating frequency or at the operating wavelength. What is the relationship between frequency and wavelength? It should be lambda equals to c by f. Lambda equals to c by f. So, mathematically we can represent basically path graph equals to, you can see here, path graph equals to pt upon pr. Then pt is the transmitter power and pr is the receiving power. So, path graph is depends upon the ratio of PT upon PR. And it is also depend upon the frequency, depend upon the distance between transmitter to receiver, or depend upon the wavelength. Right? So PR upon PT means 1 by 4 pi V, now we know that lambda equals to C by R. So this is PT upon PR equals to 1 by 3 part R. Where C is the speed of light, lambda is the wavelength. Qt is the transmitting power, PR is the receiving power in the free space, and this is the distance between transmitter and receiver. Yes? Now, one important case is here. If one distance between two receivers, two receivers means, I mean, you can see here, this is the user, one ray is from directly here, and maybe some obstacle is here, one ray goes here and comes to this side. If two ray is receiving, suppose this is the D1 and this is the D2 distance from transmitter to receiver. Right? If two ray is received at the user, at the receiver side, then what is the difference between the receiving signal power and change phase denoted by non-density, delta phase. So this is equal to 10 log. 10 log resistance PR2 upon PR1. Then PR2 is the received power through the distance D2. PR1 is the received power through the distance, traveling distance D1. Main distance between transmitter to receiver D1. And PR2 is the power, received power, the distance between transmitter to receiver D2. Right? Here, if you find the PR, basically here, from this formula, from this formula now, PR, receiving power is proportional to 1 by D square. Distance square means, as you can see, signal is defined, signal means signal power, signal is proportional to 1 by distance square. If distance is increases, now signal power is decreases. Signal will attenuate, depending upon. If distance is reduces, now signal power is increases. Right? There is important relationship between signal power and the distance. Right? So this is a general formula to find the power difference if two signal is received from two different paths. Now next slide, we can see that equation. Now this part is d2 equals to 2 sine of d1. d2 means the rate taken travel distance. If this distance is just double of the direct rate, then now if distance d2 is twice the distance d1, then the difference in the two in the power is minus 6 dB. Right? Therefore the free space propagation path is 6 dB per octave. Per octave means if distance is just double, if you are increasing the propagation distance double, now the power loss is 6 dB per octave. And per octave or 20 dB per decade. How to convert the octave into decade in decibel, right? And octave means doubling the distance and decade means now 10 times increasing up, I mean the period of 10. So 20 dB per decade means the propagation path of 20 dB will be observed from a distance of 3 to 30 km. 3 to 30 km or 2 to 20 miles. Right? Because 1 mile is equal to 1.5 km. 1 mile is equal to 1.5 km means 3 km means it is a 2 miles and 30 km means a 20 miles. So there is a relationship, how to convert dB per octave to dB per decade. This is a relationship y equals to x log 2 base 10. This is the important formula which converts octave to decade, means dB per octave to dB per decade. For example, suppose let y equal to 6 dB per octave. Let this difference is minus 6 dB per octave, put it is y, and but how to convert, and this is x is the dB per decade and y is the dB per octave. So x equals to how much? This is y upon log 2 base 10. Y is how much? 6. So this is the 6 and log 2 base 10 is the 0.3010. It will come approximately 19.933 something R. This is exactly 19.933 and exactly and approximately you can put this is a 20 dB per decade. So this is the formula which converts the decibel dB per octave to dB per decade. Right? Now the process of cutting. Cutting means the signal power, reduction of signal power, received signal power is known as the cutting. The process of cutting, there are so many reasons, so many causes which fade the signal, which reduce the signal strength of the received signal. So first factor, basically, these are the small scale cutting. In communication purpose, the small scale cutting is very important compared to large scale cutting. So small scale cutting depends upon the different factors. First factor is the multi-path propagation means multi-path propagation phenomena where the ray comes at the receiver side by the multiple path. Right? Multi-path phenomena that result in the radio signal reaching the receiving antenna by two or more paths. I mean multiple paths. The essence of multipath includes constructive and destructive interference. There are two types of interference detected. in the electromagnetic field, the constructive interference is good for the communication purpose, while the destructive interference is bad for the generator, which reduces the power in the communication system. Next factor is the speed of the mobile. If user moves rapidly at a very high speed, now signal is sent in. Maybe suddenly changes from good distance to weak distance, right? So it also depends upon the speed of the mobile. And the speed of the surrounding object. Speed of the surrounding object means if it is the mobile station, suppose this is the mobile station and here the user. In between there are so many objects. Maybe the track is moving back or traveling with the high speed. So that also causes the failure. And that's the transmission bandwidth of the signal. So transmission bandwidth is very, very important for the communication purpose, right? If we have the good bandwidth, good channel bandwidth, there is no issue of the bottleneck, no issue of the speed of the communication or the frequency of the transmission, right? So very important parameter is the transmission bandwidth. If we have the sufficient bandwidth, there is no issue of the failure. Yes? Yes? Now, next slide, we can see that types of threading. There are two types of threading. One is the long term threading and other is the short term threading. Yes? Long term threading and short term threading. Basically, long term threading is calculated by the taking the mean value of the capacitance or averaging of the threading, right? And short term occurs because of the multiple paths. Now we receive electromagnetic wave from the multiple paths, right? Yes, the signal is sent RT. RT is just the signal strength of the received signal in the time domain. And RF reaches the received signal in the space domain. Yes, so the signal strength shown in figure 2 is actual received signal. How to calculate the total received signal? Now this RT, RF equal to depends upon the long term threading into the short term threading. Suppose MP is the long term threading. MP reaches the long term threading signal and R0T reaches the small term or short term threading. So multiplication of these two gives the total distance of the received signal, distance of the threaded signal, right? So this is the equation number 1. This is the time domain, similarly you can put this is in the space domain. R x equals to M x into R naught x. So this is the space domain and this is the time domain. Clear? Now in the next slide, I am going to discuss the long term threading in detail. Clear? Long term threading, the long term signal threading is mainly caused by the pairing configuration. And the built environment between the base station and the mobile station. Earlier, I told you about the pairing configuration and the human base environment. Pairing configuration is the open area, flat terrain, hilly terrain, and mountain area. While the human base environment is the rural area, versus suburban, urban, and suburban. So, pairing configuration causes local need, long term threading. Local need is long term threading. Attenuation and fluctuation, whereas the human made environment only causes the local need attenuation. In simple words, you can say the terrain configuration causes the two types of attenuation. I mean, attenuation and fluctuation, while human made only causes the attenuation. Yes, local need attenuation. From this diagram you can see, if users move away from the base station, move away from the base station. At this point, you can see here, now if user moving in this direction, now signal strength is continuously decreases. At this point, again decreases, then increases, then increases. As there are three points. At this point, here, then there are three points. This is the minimum, local minimum of the signal strength value. Clear? Now this is the x1 minus l and is the now this from here to here l, from here to here l. X1 minus l, x1 plus l. This point is basically l. X1. Right? So what is how to calculate the last term fitting? Now you can see here the estimated local mean at point x1. At point x1 means at this point. This is x1 and we are then putting here L, this is L. So we have calculated the last of gradient between two values. So this point is basically x1 minus L, this point is basically x1 plus L. Right? If you are calculating the estimated local mean at point x1 in our x-axis, can be expressed mathematically m as x equals to 1 by 2 because we have calculated the non-term period which is 1 by 2. 1 by 2 m, lower limit is x1 minus l and upper limit is x1 plus l and r x. X is the basically received signal, received period signal in the space domain. Clear? So, we know that now this r x equals to m x into r dot x, where m x is the long-term fitting and r dot x is the short-term fitting, right? Now assume that m x 1 is the true local mean, then the point x 1 is this figure. If x equals to x 1, then m x equals to m x 1. And here, where x is varying from local minimum means x 1 minus m and the upper minimum that is x1 plus l. Yes, when l is chosen properly, then this local mean of this signal strength m as x1 equals to mx1, mx1 into 1 by 2 n, x1 minus l2, x1 plus l, r and l. Where we put this mx out from the integration. Yes, two legs. And then x is opposed to mx1 by the following relationship. If this m at x1 is approaches to mx1, now this integration is going to be unity. Going to be unity means this local mean long-term value is equal to the long-term fading at the point x1. Yes, the length f will be determined after fully understanding of statistical characteristics of the star of fading. Yes, so why is this way? Mathematically we can calculate the loss of fading. Yes, under the certain circumstances, the fluctuation of loss of fade caused by the fading configuration can form a normal distribution because of the statistical nature of the fluctuation of the signal is denoted by this way. Mathematically, this can be written as now this is the PM. PM equals to PM is the basically non-normal distribution. This is equal to 1 upon under root 2 pi sigma e to the power minus m minus m is the mean value capital m minus m whole square upon 2 sigma square, where m is the true signal in the mean. Then small m two single names. Decimal and capital M is the area address signal of area average signal R M is the mean of two signals and sigma is the standard deviation. Yes. Now before starting the the wireless radio, I would like to know about what is difference between the radio path and the mobile path. So radio path is the path that radio wave travels. Radio path is the path that the radio wave travels. And mobile path? Mobile path is the path that the mobile unit is traveling. Yes. So this is the difference between radio waves and mobile waves. On next slide, I would like to discuss about the two phases of the long term fading. So phase first, when mobile unit is circling around the base station. Circling around the base station means, suppose this is the base station. This is the base station and this is the case. This is the user who is circularly rotating the base station. Circularly moving the base station, right? In this case, you can see the elevation versus the space. Now you can see here, the received signal is varying like this. Yes, and signal strength or fluid strength is constant varying as a sinusoidal signal. This is the local limit, right? Yes, means the signal strength is not suddenly varying. It has the almost constant and slightly varying from this one. You can see from the figure, this is the vegetation, this one is vegetation, and trees are moving around this. Right? Around this, the signal strength is not suddenly varying. It's slowly fluctuating. Signal slowly fluctuating. You can see from this diagram. Case second is when the mobile unit is moving away from the base station. Moving, suppose this is the base station, this is the base station and this is the user. Moving away from the base station. This is the base station, this is the user. This is moving away from the base station. Then the fluctuation of the long term fading received is affected by the radial fading counter. The mobile travels in a certain direction. The radio path corresponds to the mobile path. In the latter case, the terrain counters where the mobile unit travels has a strong correlation with the received signal as when seen in the figure. This is the elevation, it is slightly varying, and the signal strength. You can see here the more fluctuation of the signal strength. If it is circularly rotated in the base station, the fluctuation is small. But if mobile unit is traveling far away from the station, now the fluctuation is the large. So these are the two phases of the long term fading. The next topic is the short term fading. Next topic is the short term fading. Basically, earlier I told you the short term fading is dependent upon the multiple paths received, signal electromagnetic waves received through the multiple paths. So, short wave fading is mainly caused by the multi path reflection of the transmitted wave by local scatter such as houses, buildings, and other human built structures. And other human built structures are by natural obstacles such as forests surrounding a mobile unit. It is not caused by a natural obstruction such as mountains or trees located between the transmitting and the receiving areas. Right? In explaining the process of short-term fading, the base station, transmitter, the mobile station, receiver, they are characterized into the four cases. Yes? So the duration of the analysis of the quantum fitting basically depends upon the different cases. Here we categorize into the four cases. So case first, in the case first, you can see from the next slide, the mobile receiver is dynamically surrounded by the moving objects such as tracker. The receive signal is so steady. The number of pairs will depend upon the traffic flow of the tracker and the distance between the tracker and mobile receiver. You can see from this diagram. This is the actual user. This is the actual user. Now this is the wave generation antenna. Yes? Now user is still fit. In between user and base station, there are so many moving packages are traveling. Now this is traveling. What? This is the pattern, this is the tracker. These are the tracker which are rotating or moving in between the base station antenna and the mobile user. Now you can see from this diagram. Now, signal strength is not slightly varying. Now, you can see signal strength is like this, then suddenly decreases because of the aspect is come between mobile station, this and the user. Again, traveling, maybe here, due to this moving packages, now signal strength decreases. Due to this, maybe signal strength decreases. Due to this, maybe signal strength decreases. So, because of the moving object between the mobile station and the base station, now the signal may be reduced. Now, this kind of heading is known as small scale fading. So, this is case first of the fading. Case second. In the case second, the mobile station is moving with the velocity V. If there is no single scatter around the mobile unit, as you can see in the figure, with the base station, this is the user. User is moving in this direction, means from the sea level, it travels at the theta angle. And there is no any object in between mobile station and the base station. Now you can find the good signal strength. The good signal strength, right? Then how to calculate the fading frequency? Now, fading frequency can be calculated as, yes, in this case the receive signal can be represented, suppose S, R, represent the receive signal, object for receive, S for signal, receive signal, this is the receive signal can be represented by assuming as incoming signal arriving at angle theta. Incoming signal arriving at angle theta with respect to motion of a mobile unit. So this can be represented as the A exponential of the J 2 pi F T minus beta S cos theta. Beta S cos theta. Where F is the transmitter frequency, and X is the distance or displacement. Where this is equal to velocity into time, V into T. And beta is the wave number of propagation constant. Wave number R, propagation constant, this is equal to theta is equal to 2 pi by delta, that's the wavelength, operating equation, right? And that is the operating wavelength. Yes? Now, we can rewrite this equation. Suppose this is equation number 1. We can write this equation like as 2 by gamma. This This is equal to A, it has been J2 by FP minus FP minus beta x cos theta upon 2 by T. Now below that, FP beta 2 by A number, X is B into T upon 2 by A. T doesn't come up, by 2 by T. So cos theta. By this tangent by 2 pi, this tangent by t. Now we will get the exponential of j 2 pi f t minus b by lambda cos theta. Yes, b by lambda cos theta r. This is equal to, this is equation number 2. Where B by lambda into cos theta is known as spreading frequency. Where our Doppler frequency FD equals to B by lambda cos theta. B by lambda cos theta. This is known as Doppler frequency. Yeah? So this is the mathematical relationship to find the Doppler frequency of the resonance signal. So this is B by lambda into cos theta. So we can put here the resonance signal. The resonance signal is basically resonance signal equal to J exponential of J 2 pi F t minus F d. This is the equation number 3. Right? Now we can put this FP minus FD equals to FR. FR is the receiving frequency. Where receiving frequency, FR is the receiving frequency. FR is equal to FP minus FP minus FD R B by lambda into cos theta. This is equation number 4. Yes?